Books on Tape presents Laura Bush, An Intimate Portrait of the First Lady by Ronald Kessler. Read by Susan Denaker. Prologue. When the call came in just after 6 p.m. on October 20th, 2004, Laura Bush had just finished an hour-long yoga session with Pamela Hudson Nelson, her high school friend from Midland, Texas. The day before, USA Today had run an interview with Teresa Hines Carey. When asked how she would be different from Laura Bush as First Lady, the wife of the Democratic presidential candidate sniffed, "I don't know that she's ever had a real job." Within hours, Hines, who would drop Carey from her name after the election, issued an apology. Now she was calling the First Lady. Having finished their yoga in the exercise room on the third floor of the White House, Laura and Nelson were on the second floor of the residence in Laura's dressing room. Off the first couple's bedroom, the dressing room had a chaise longue, a fireplace, a small desk, drawers for jewelry, and racks of clothes in cleaner's bags. Pinned to the bags were lists of when and where each item had been worn. With a touch of drama, Daniel Shanks, an usher, came in and announced Hines's call. Also present were Lindsay M. Lineweaver, Laura's assistant and personal aide, and Maria Galvan, the Bush's personal housekeeper from Austin. In photos, Lineweaver could be seen with Laura carrying a huge bag that held the First Lady's extra contact lenses and CoverGirl makeup. It was 12 days before the election, and Laura had been out campaigning in New York, New Hampshire, and Pennsylvania. Today was her only break from the campaign, and she and her husband were planning to enjoy a rare dinner together with their daughters and Pamela Nelson. The next day, Laura was set to leave again for New Hampshire. The president was heading for Pennsylvania. Earlier that afternoon, after Hines's public apology, Laura had told reporters that there had been no need for her to do so. "I know how tough it is, and actually, I know those trick questions," she said. Laura did not take Teresa's call. Instead, she turned to Andrea G. Andy Ball, her chief of staff in the White House and during the years Laura had been First Lady of Texas. "Let's not make this into anything," she said. "Call her back and tell her that Mrs. Bush understands that when you talk to the media, things get quoted that you didn't quite say or mean to say." Ball went back to her office in the East Wing and called Hines's assistant. Unlike Hillary Clinton, who moved the First Lady's office to the West Wing, Laura has her office in the East Wing. However, she operates most of the time out of a small office in the residence portion of the White House. That office is also where she has her hair done. Ball told the assistant that if Teresa was calling about her comment, there was no need for either of them to take time out of their day to talk about it. "Mrs. Bush thinks nothing of it. I don't think Mrs. Carey meant that she never worked." Pamela Nelson had been staying overnight at the White House for several days each month for meetings of the Commission on Fine Arts, which reviews and approves architectural plans submitted by the federal and District of Columbia governments. As Laura continued selecting clothes to pack, she explained to Nelson, "If I took the call from Mrs. Carey, it would escalate. The next story will be, Mrs. Carey talked to Mrs. Bush. I don't want this to be news. I don't want reporters to grab this and start beating up on Teresa Carey. She doesn't know how to talk to the media. She blurts things out. You can't blurt." Despite Laura's excuses for Teresa Hines, her comments in the USA Today interview were not off-the-cuff responses during a high-pressure press conference. They were part of a recorded Q&A. Hines had apparently forgotten that, for 10 years, Laura had been an elementary school teacher and librarian at inner-city schools. Hines also appeared to be implying that women who don't have jobs and devote themselves to raising a family are unworthy of respect. Soon after this, Press Secretary Gordon Jandreau called Laura at the residence to say that a new Gallup poll for USA Today and CNN showed that 74% of Americans had a favorable opinion of her. Only 16% had an unfavorable opinion. "We're going to get those 16%, Jandreau told Laura jokingly. "We're going to wring their necks and get them over to us." The following year, Laura's approval rating would soar to 85%, according to a Gallup poll. Since opinion polls first began asking about them in 1939, no First Lady had received a higher rating. After Hillary Clinton and Oprah Winfrey, Laura Bush was the most admired woman in America. At the table that night in the pale green family dining room, Laura took the same positive approach to Teresa Hines's remark as she had in public. Bush had been campaigning that day in Iowa, Minnesota, and Wisconsin. His arrival for dinner at 8 p.m. did not have to be announced. Laura and Pamela Nelson could hear the helicopter, Marine One, landing on the South Lawn. After Bush took his place at the dinner table, he said grace. "Sometimes I've been asked to say grace, which is a little nerve-wracking because of where you are and maybe who is sitting around the table," Nelson observed. "You never know who is going to be asked, so you have a little prayer just in case he goes, 'Pam, go pray.' One time I kind of waited too long. I was taking deep yoga breaths." "Are you going to come out with it?" Bush asked.
"Wait, it's coming out," Nelson responded.
That October 20, 2004 evening, as a butler passed cheese and chicken enchiladas, daughters Jenna and Barbara Bush expressed outrage at Teresa's comment. Typically, Jenna was the more vocal.
"You know, Mom, she put down every woman who raised their children," Jenna said. "She was saying that's not a real job. That was what was so bad about it. Not that she forgot you had a teaching job, but that she was putting down raising children."
Meanwhile, Nelson, a vegetarian, selected a chicken enchilada by mistake. Laura plucked it from her friend's plate and put it on her own. She then talked about how easy it was for words to be twisted and taken out of context.
"You know that comment, 'bring them on,'" Laura said, referring to Bush's July 2003 statement challenging those who would attack American forces in Iraq.
"It had so many political repercussions. Everything can be used a million times against you."
"This has to be the meanest campaign ever," Nelson said.
"No, the leaflets they dropped when Lincoln was running that disparaged him and his family were horrible," Laura said. "People blame everything that happens on this office." Bush was tired from his trip and expressed no opinion about Hines's comment. Instead, Nelson recalled, every time the butler came in, the president asked who was ahead in the St. Louis Cardinals versus Houston Astros National League championship. After dinner, Bush went into his office in the residence and worked a hand-cut mahogany jigsaw puzzle lent to the White House by Elms Puzzles of Maine. Another Elms puzzle was a present from the White House staff. Imprinted on it was the face of Barney, the Bush's omnipresent Scottish Terrier. Among themselves, members of the Bush campaign staff were expressing joy over Hines's comment. On behalf of the campaign, Karen Hughes took the offensive, saying on television that Hines's remarks were indicative of an unfortunate mindset that seeks to divide women based on who works at home and who works outside the home. Donald L. Evans, Bush's close friend who had attended Bible study with him and had been present at the dinner that precipitated Bush's decision to give up drinking, was in Florida when he heard about Hines's comment. "I couldn't believe it," Evans, Bush's Commerce Secretary, said. "When I first heard it, I thought it had been misreported."
In fact, the comment reflected a prevalent view among the 16% of Americans who said they did not have a favorable opinion of Laura. While that view rarely appeared in print, in certain liberal circles, it was fashionable to express disdain at the mention of Laura Bush.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.